My name is Lars Nordstro, born and raised in Stockholm, came to Oregon in the 80s, and now I have lived here continuously for 31 years. On the one hand, I've been a farmer of grapes, and on the other, I have been a translator and a writer, and I've been active with this non-profit educational organization called Swedish Roots in Oregon. And our mission has been to research and document and publish the history of the Swedes in the state. Tonight I will present our latest book, which is called Swedish Roots, Oregon Lives. It's a collection of oral histories. These are Swedish immigrants and children of Swedish immigrants during the 20th century who have either come or were born into Swedish families here. And these are various dimensions of the Swedish experience in the state during the 20th century. This project is really the continuation of our original mission, which was to document the history of the Swedes in the state of Oregon in various ways, both by historical research, oral history, and also genealogical research. We had learned that the Swedes during the period 1880 to 1940 were the second largest immigrant group, and we also learned that there were no books in English at all describing this large immigrant group, what kind of experiences they had had. So that's that void of no information available in English really inspired us to do not just this book, but the two previous books too.
We have with us Lars Nordstro. He was born in Sweden and educated at the University of Stockholm and Portland State University. He has a bachelor's degree in English and a PhD in American literature. He has received several Fulbright grants, a Scandinavian Foundation grant for academic research in the U.S., several Swedish Institute grants and awards, as well as a Rockefeller Foundation Bellagio Center Fellowship. He's published prose, poetry, translations, interviews, at least a couple of books, more than a couple of books. He's been working for the nonprofit research project, Swedish Roots in Oregon. And tonight he's come out to visit us to share stories from his book, Swedish Roots, Oregon Lives, an oral history project. We'll have books for sale after the event. Please join us in welcoming Lars Nordstro.
This is wonderful to be back. I was here a couple of years ago talking about our first book, which was called Swedish Oregon, which was really a history of the Swedes in the state of Oregon. And today, it is a book of oral histories. And the way I thought I'd structure the evening is that I'll start by kind of framing Swedish emigration to the U.S. and to Oregon, and I'll talk a little bit about that, and then I'll talk a little bit about oral history as a form to convey personal history and the history of the times. And why I like it so much, because I really do like oral history a lot. And so I'll try to spend about 15 minutes in the introduction, and then I'll be reading some excerpts from some of the stories. It will just be excerpts, and I won't even have a chance to read from all the stories in this book, but just a few. So that's how, and then I'll open it up at the end for comments and questions that you may have. So, you know, most people don't know. Everybody knows that there were four colonial powers in North America that became the United States and Canada: England, France, Spain, and Holland. What people don't know is that there was a fifth colonial power for a very short time, and that was Sweden. And actually, two of the first original 13 states, Pennsylvania and Delaware, were first settled by Swedes. Pennsylvania is built on a Swedish settlement. So the Swedes were here early, and this was a kind of a colonization attempt. This is a period in history, the 1600s, where Sweden was a major power in North Europe, but it was unable to hang on to it. It was government-sponsored. They shipped a bunch of people over. They introduced a log cabin to American history and culture, and it traveled west and became maybe the most important Swedish contribution. Some say, of course, it was Swedish Finns, or Finns, who were then considered Swedish because Finland didn't exist, who had the log cabin, but that's lost in the fog of history, but they brought it anyway. So then, you know, Swedish history kind of petered out, and before the American Civil War, what is known as the beginning of the Great Migration, which spans 75 years, started. And the first people to leave were religious freedom seekers. This is now pre-Civil War period, 1850. And they were people who were part of the Pietist movement in Europe, which involved reading the Bible for themselves and interpreting scripture in new ways that the Lutheran-sponsored church did not approve of. So they were harassed. They were not killed, but they were harassed. They were put in jail. Bread and water was not unusual. Meetings, prayer meetings and such were not permitted. So these people did not want to remain in Sweden. They left and they came to the United States. It's a relatively small number, but they came nevertheless, and they all settled in Illinois and in that part of the early Midwest. And Swedish immigration, of course, moved westward as the American expansion happened westward. After the Civil War, Swedish emigration started in earnest. There were some really bad years. 1867 to 1869 were famine years. Lots of people actually starved to death in northern Scandinavia. It was very difficult. Some think it was related to a volcanic eruption that made the summers extremely cold. Crops didn't ripen, and there was mass starvation. And that kind of triggered this great emigration. Sweden also had a growing population, which was due to vaccinations, and it was a totally agrarian society. There was no industry by 1850. It was all 40% of the population in 1850 were landless farm workers. They were working on one-year contracts, going from farm to farm, and they had no hope. All the arable land had been claimed. There was no more land to take up, and it was a very tough situation. The cities were small. There was no factories. No alternatives, so no wonder they emigrated. They started coming, so they were landless farm workers, some tradespeople, you know, people actually had other jobs than farming. There were shoemakers and, you know, craftspeople, saddle makers, and all the things that needed to be done in an agrarian society. Crofters, and a croft is a farm that's attached to an estate that's run by and owned by an aristocrat, and you work for this aristocrat in exchange for the land that you live on, where you can have a small garden. So that was very common. There were maids also, people who actually, women who worked as maids in the upper class houses. And most of the people who came after the Civil War came from a province called Småland, which is south central. Also from Värmland, which is a province bordering Norway, kind of western Sweden. Lots of people there. As during this whole time, immigration accelerated. In the 1880s, 300,000 Swedes passed through Liverpool. 300,000 Swedes. And they all came to America. Many of them traveled all the way out, as we'll see later. The railroad connected Portland to the national grid in 1883. And that was actually the first railroad into what had been the Oregon Territory. So there was no railroad to Seattle in 1883. Everybody came through Portland. So this was the major hub. And this then coincided with the peak of Swedish emigration. So many actually came directly all the way from Sweden through Chicago. They almost all came through Chicago. They got on the Northern Pacific, and they came out to Portland. So that sort of helped accelerate Swedish emigration to here. After about 1890, the people leaving were mostly tradespeople. The farmers and the landless farm workers had already left. So there were people with trades. They had been trained, maybe sheet metal workers, railroad construction, whatever it was that they knew. They had skills, maybe carpenters, maybe sawmill workers. So they could get other jobs than just farming. And when they came out west, there wasn't so much farming because there was so much clearing that had to happen. You know, this was all forested, so logging had to happen first, and then the farming came second. And then in the 20th century, up until the Depression, it was actually mostly forest industry workers and construction trades, often from northern Sweden. Southern Sweden had already emptied out by this time of the surplus people, so it was tradespeople. Then comes the Great Depression, and during the 1930s, every year during the 1930s, more Swedes actually went back than came here. And this is true for not just for the Swedes, but all the Scandinavians. And so basically, Swedish emigration ends in 1929. That's the end of the Swedish emigration, the Great Migration. 1.2 million Swedes left. That's 20% of the population. That would be equal to about 66 million Americans leaving today to go to somewhere else over a 75-year period. It's a lot of people. It's a lot of people. Most people in Sweden have relatives here, more or less distant. I'm in the exception. I'm the first one to go. So I don't have any relatives here. So that's in a nutshell, you know, what the Swedish emigration was like. It's also interesting, I've spent some time at the Oregon Historical Society to discover that the state of Oregon actually promoted Northern Europeans to come to Oregon. They translated promotional material, and this kind of was aimed at loggers, farmers, fishermen, all the things, construction workers who could, you know, build houses out of wood, all of these things, the Swedes and the Norwegians and the Finns and the Danes, they all knew how to do this. And so they were attracted here. Between 1880 and 1940, the Swedes were the second largest immigrant group in the state of Oregon after the Germans. And someone said that if you counted the Swedish-speaking Finns, they were probably larger than that German group. And if you add all the Scandinavians together, they clearly dominated the immigrant mix in Oregon at that time. In Washington State at that time, the Swedes were far outnumbered any other immigrant group, even the Germans. So Washington was a really Swedish state. And you still see it, you know, when you drive five. I drove up to Seattle the other day, and all the names, the Swedish names on the businesses, you know, you still see these remnants of these people. So, and of course, Oregon, you know, as you know, was a small state. It didn't reach 1 million citizens until 1940. So, you know, this was really a sparsely populated state for a long time. And during this time, 1880, when the railroad opened up the territory and the Swedes started coming, they kept a really vibrant community alive. There was a Swedish newspaper that was published in Portland every week in Swedish, and this was a tremendous help to the immigrants because they could read in their native language, and the Swedes were very literate. They were one of the most literate people in Europe at that time. So they could read the newspaper and learn about conditions here, get information about all kinds of things. They could also read news about Sweden. You know, everybody wanted to know what was happening back home. So, this magazine was published every week. It ran from 1908 until 1936. Then it merged with other Swedish newspapers and was published out of Seattle as Svenska Posten, the Swedish Post. And it was done in Swedish. And it ended in 1974 or 76, can't quite remember. And I came here the first time in 1978, and I felt like I had come into a vacuum. There was no way. This was before internet, you know? And there was no way to find out anything about what happened in Sweden. It was never in the news. It was on the other side of the planet. A letter took 10 days, and then it took 10 days back. It was very difficult that there wasn't a paper. So, you know, but there was more than the paper. There were churches, organizations, we'll hear some of that, and restaurants, there were stores, grocery stores, clothing stores, dentists, lawyers, everything. Many people didn't even learn English because you didn't need to. You can actually get along. So, you know, so that's sort of in a nutshell a little bit about the Swedish emigration to Oregon. So this oral history project started long before I came, actually, and became involved in this. And people started realizing, oh, some of these old immigrants are dying off. We better preserve their voices. So they started recording them. And the problem was that many of these recordings were not transcribed initially, which means that you put it down on paper. And when you do that, you discover that you have all kinds of questions. You know, sometimes there are contradictions. Sometimes questions aren't really answered. There could be meanderings and so on and so forth. And if the person who told the story passes away, then there's no way to ask. And so we actually had to discard quite a few recordings because the people were gone and there were just too many question marks. So we lost some. So, but anyway, we had some that were done, and Portland State actually did a very interesting project. So they were encouraging oral histories, not just among the Swedes, but students who had relatives who were connected to the immigration were encouraged to do, and the professors would help them with the process of oral history. So we got a couple of wonderful stories that came by way of Portland State University and what they had done. So, you know, the oral history process, I'll just tell you briefly, because it's a little bit deceptive. When you pick up and read a book like this, you'll discover it reads very smoothly. And, you know, that's the result of a lot of work. And first you have to prepare your questions, you know, think out, what is it that I'm going to ask this person about? Then you actually have to find time to sit down and do the interview. Okay, you do that. Then you go home and you transcribe it. You write it down actually word for word what this person says. Then you have all these questions. So then you have to go back to the person and get those questions answered. Then you have to transcribe that, edit that. Then you can start the process of editing the text to make it readable, you know, because we have kept the originals. So if anyone wants to read the originals, they're available. But these are much more readable. So. And then we also always give the person telling the story the opportunity to read through the final version and say, okay, you know, I'm okay with this. Sometimes people will say something. You know, Swedish people up until, I'll just tell this as a good example. Swedish people up until, say, World War II, had probably never seen a black person, except maybe in a circus. So when they came to America and they saw black people, it was a shock. It was not like it was racism, but it was something they'd never seen before. You know, and some people made comments about this, you know, coming through Ellis Island. Like, here are these black people working here, and they got really upset, you know, because they'd never seen black people. And so then they said these things, and then they felt uncomfortable. They said, well, maybe people think I'm a racist, you know, but it was just so strange and alien to us. We'd never seen colored people before. So, you know, so then you have to sort of have a dialogue. Well, it's an interesting that you have that reaction, you know, because it's true that this happened and you responded this way, and it's part of the historical experience. You'd never seen black people. So, you know, so there were all kinds of little issues that come up that you want the person telling the story to feel comfortable with the story in the end, you know. And there are many such examples. I can tell you more in the question and answer session if you're interested. And then, you know, then it's a question of selecting stories. Well, what stories do you select? And we did not base it on whether people could speak Swedish, how many times they'd been back to Sweden, or if they were active in the Swedish American community. We wanted good stories, and we wanted a range of stories. So that's really how we selected the material. And then, you know, I mentioned initially here, why oral history? Well, oral history is very interesting because storytelling is an ancient form. We've told stories ever since we left Africa 70,000 years ago. We've been sitting around campfires telling stories. And this is really, you notice it in children when you read stories to children. They just get totally into it, and you can read forever. They don't want to go to bed. They want to hear one more chapter because the stories grab us. So I think we're kind of hardwired for stories. I mean, novels, films, they're all good stories. And they explain things. They explain human behavior. They explain the natural environment, the mystery of existence, you know, all of these things. And so I think for those reasons, they're really good. And I also think that we live in a culture that kind of emphasizes the, the trivial or the excessive. And we know this is not true, you know, but this is kind of, this sells products or it sells something, and so people exaggerate and lie and tell these incredible stories that can't possibly be true. You know, we know this when we hear these stories, but oral histories are true stories. They're human stories. They're just stories like ours, you know. It's just different people. And I think we're drawn to them because we know that they're honest and that they are real, not fantasy, not titillation, you know. So I'd say it's a powerful antidote to the shallowness of sensationalism. And then, of course, our own lives is the biggest story we have. This is, you know, the life we live, this is our story, and that's the biggest story. And who is more qualified to tell it than the person telling the story? So everyone is an expert about his own life. Not everybody is great storytellers, but most people have really interesting stories. And of course, they are also stories that don't try to sell anything. You know, they're just trying to tell you what they've experienced in life and share that with you. They're not trying to sell a product to you, you know. So all these things are good. And they reflect two worlds, the family world, the personal world, but also because they're recorded at a certain time in history, they reflect larger trends in society. So they kind of give us a glimpse of the times where people speak. I've probably rambled on too long here. You know, we're not going to get so many stories, but there's a lot to say about these. I want to start the first story with this guy. He was born 1898, Oscar Näsström. He died in 1987. He was a musician. He could play several instruments. He'd played on this symphony orchestra in Omaha. And then he got to a ranch up in Wyoming before coming to Oregon. And this is his story. And this takes place right around World War II. And he says, I finally left Omaha and worked on the railroad for some time. After that, I went to Wyoming because I took my sister up there, and when her husband was working, he lived there. He had moved there by himself, so that's why I ended up on a ranch in Wyoming. It was rugged. I had a cattle ranch, but I didn't have enough stock, and then the government told me I had to go into defense. There was a war on, after all. I don't know what I would have been if the government hadn't taken me out of that place. When I think about the winters, I had some tough winters there all alone, right on the Colorado border. In fact, the man at the station asked me where I worked, and when I said I had a ranch up there, he said, you're on that ranch? It's too hard to get up there. The last man who had that ranch, we hauled off dead. He froze to death. Well, you're looking at a Swede now, I told him. I didn't know where to go, to Oregon or California, but I had a lot of friends who had gone to Oregon and they found life sweet there. I'm sure glad I went to Oregon and left Wyoming and that ranch behind. I came to Portland in 1943 and I didn't know anybody here. When I got off the train, I had an awful time getting into a hotel because there were so many people coming here to work for defense. And you know, that was the shipbuilding that was happening in the Columbia River. Eventually, I found a poor hotel down on Burnside. The day after I arrived, I walked out on Burnside to see if I could find any Swedish names on businesses or something. There was one, Ericsson's, down on the corner. So I went down there, and just as I took hold of the door, it flew open, and someone had a fellow by the neck and threw him outside, right out. So I thought to myself, I'm not going in there yet. I looked across the street, and there was a sign up that said Valhalla. And that's the place of the gods in Norse mythology, you know. Across the street from that was a place called Viking. So I thought, my goodness, I'm going in there. People were coming from vacation and they were having a good time eating fish, herring, and everything. I looked around and sat down at a long table. I asked the fellow sitting next to me what he was eating. I'm eating smelt, he said. I'd never heard of smelt before, so I said, what's that? It's good, he said. You better have some smelt. So the waiter came up and asked me what I wanted, and I said I wanted smelt, and he got some for me. Then I asked him if he knew of any Swedish organizations here in Portland. Oh, sure, he said. Lots of them, both Norwegian and Swedish. Linnea Lodge, Harmony Lodge, Nobel Lodge. I told him it was nice to know, and when I got through eating, I went out on the street, and there were two fellows standing there. They didn't seem too intoxicated. I asked them where I could find Linnea Lodge. One of the guys says, have you ever heard of her? The other guy says, "You're stupid, that isn't a woman. That's the place where the Swedes go." So finally he told me to get there. "Well, you're in Burnside now," he said. "You have to go 5 blocks up and then you..." "No, you go 3 blocks and then you turn left." "No, that's wrong too." They had me going in all directions. Finally, he said, "Mister, I don't think you can get there from here." So that was Oskar Nyström's, welcoming to Portland, and he liked it. You know, he found his way to the Linnea Lodge, which was not a woman, but he ran into a Swedish woman there and married her and lived his whole life here. So that was really he's a great storyteller, that guy. Oskar Nyström. I met him very briefly before he passed away, but I can't say that I really got to know him. You know, and I read this little excerpt. This is Emma Nordgren. She was born, let me see here, I'll quote the years right. She was from the north of Sweden, 1901 to 1998. And she came from a very poor family up north, and the father had gone ahead. They didn't have enough money for tickets for everybody. So the father went ahead to kind of check things out, get a job and work and save up money and send for tickets. Took him 8 years to send for his wife and his kid, who was then 8 years old. So then they came over and the family was reunited. This was kind of an interesting comment. He said, "My father lived with us and we were together as a family. He and mother didn't speak Swedish with each other. Mother had felt at a real disadvantage because she didn't know English and she had been laughed at so many times that she said that she, if she learned to speak English, she would never speak Swedish again. And she didn't. As a result, neither my brother nor my sister knows anything of the language. My siblings were both born in Boise. I'm about 10 years older, my brother, and 14 years older than my sister." So she had been 8 years in Sweden, so she did speak Swedish. But it's a very common thread through all these stories that the parents stop speaking Swedish. And it is part of, you know, losing cultural heritage when you don't speak the language. But it is very difficult because, you know, it's an uphill battle. I managed to transmit Swedish to my kids, but it was really not easy. And then, you know, Swedes think that, today people might think that Swedes had a really easy time in America, but there was a lot of discrimination. Listen to this. This is still Emma Nordgren. "Then came World War I, and people began talking about Germany and the Germans. There were a lot of Germans living in our neighborhood, as well as a sprinkling of Danes. I went to a school with a couple of German girls whose older brother enlisted in the war, and the family took an awful lot of flack from Americans only because they were German. And then people heard that we were Swedish, we're Swedes, and to some that meant we were part German. And because we had friends and neighbors who were German, we were considered pro-German and as bad as them, and we got a lot of grief. I couldn't understand it and talked to my German friend Catherine about it. She explained to me that we Swedes had trouble not only because we associated with Germans, we were also from Europe, and for that reason alone, we must be German sympathizers. Dad was fired from the stone quarry where he worked only because he was considered pro-German. So Dad said, 'To hell with it, we're going to a bigger city.' That's when we came here to Portland, and Dad found work in the shipyards, and we have been here ever since." So, and you'll hear, I read some other excerpts that, you know, just because you were Swedish was no, you know, ticket to discrimination. There was actually a fair amount of it. And I'm going to read one more snippet from Emma's story because this was really an eye-opener to me. Sometimes you wonder why contact is broken between families. Well, this is one explanation. "Well, you come to the land of opportunity, the land of milk and honey. You're trying to make it here. You get a job here, and the people you leave behind, your family, think, 'Oh boy, he's making it, earning so much money in America.' A lot of people send money home, the Scandinavians, the Greeks, and the Italians, they all did. We had just bought this property and put a little crude shack on it that we lived in when mother got a letter from her sister in Örnsköldsvik. Their youngest child, a girl, was just graduating from high school and had been majoring in music, and my aunt thought it would be so nice if Aunt Anna and Uncle August could send some money for a grand piano. Could they possibly help her? When I came home from work that evening, Mother was holding the letter in her hand. She was half crying, half laughing. "Of all the nerve," she said, "where in the name of God would we get all that money?" I told her to write back and tell them the truth. They, of course, didn't know any better. A lot of people had that stupid pride that wouldn't let them know back home that you worked but didn't make a fortune from it. An Italian once came into the photo studio where I worked. He was an elevator operator for J.K. Gill Company and needed a photo taken for Citizen Papers. He was kind of apologetic, but I told him I was a naturalized citizen too. Lots of people were so busy that they didn't have time to worry about their papers. I told him that I had relatives in Sweden, and he told me about his in Italy. He was sending money to some of them, and they thought that he was wealthy. I told him about my family's request for a piano, and that the reason for this was that my mother had been too proud to write and tell them that we were having a rough time of it. Mother said that it wasn't possible for me to understand what it was like. You know, so a lot of people came here, and of course, you know, with the hope, of course, of, you know, improving their lot. And in Sweden, their relatives thought, well, you know, everyone who came here became really wealthy and successful and did really well. But the majority, of course, just lived ordinary lives, and some really struggled. And this led to, you know, communication ceasing in the families, that they didn't maintain it. So that was really, and I hadn't really thought of that before I heard this snippet in the story. And then I remember when I had two sons, when they were preteen, they were probably about 12 or so. We were going to send them to the relatives in Sweden on airplanes. And they got this little thing around their neck, you know, you took them to the airport, and then someone from the airline was going to walk them from one gate to the next, you know. We were so nervous. Oh, what if they get lost? And, oh, they're at this big airport. Well, this is what happened 100 years ago. Years later, I talked to one of Mother's cousins, and she said, "How could we do that to those children? How could we just blithely put them on the train?" Because they sent the kids on the train to emigrate to America on their own. I've thought about it. At the time, we just accepted it. We got to Gothenburg and got off the train, went along with the rest of the people. We just went through all the physical exams and everything. It was just like you were being taken care of. Somehow or other, it evolved. The whole thing evolved. And we got on this big ship. There was tourist, second class, and first class. We were in the tourist class. Steerage people were the ones with the babushkas and the pack sacks. I don't know where they came from, but they were real poor. They appeared like they were from southern countries. I don't know why they would be coming there, coming out of Gothenburg. It was quite a trip, though, 9 to 10 day trip across the ocean, and we were seasick. Martha said that she dreamed about Grandpa. He was walking and coming towards us on the water. We were just delirious, I guess. We were so sick for about 3 days, but we survived. We just accepted whatever came. When we arrived in New York, we had to stay on board the ship. We wondered why we couldn't land. They had an epidemic at Ellis Island, and that was the reason why we couldn't land. But we had messages from Mother that she was meeting us in New York, and she came down to the dock, to the wharf where the ship had landed. We were quite a ways from her, but she would come down and stand there and wave to us while she was waiting for us. We were frightened by so many people and so many different nationalities, and we were frightened by the Negro porters. We'd never seen Negroes except in the circuses. They checked us for lice. They checked us for lice at Gothenburg even before we left, but we were put through that treatment for lice here too. We didn't dare move away from where we were put. I remember that somebody told you where to go, where to sit, and where to stay. We had tags on us, who we were and where we were going and everything else. All of this frightened Elise, that was a sister, so much the following year, because when they got to Ellis Island, they had to stay there for a week, and they were thrown in with all these people. They couldn't understand them or anything else. They were all in there, Greeks and Italians. So, you know, parents actually put teenager on the train for a 30-day immigration trip. And these kids had never been out of the local village. It was quite a, you know, they were brave. They were really brave. So this next story is a guy who is really distantly related to me. You can follow this. I'll just do it one time. My mother's sister married this guy, my uncle. He had a sister who's Morris's mother. So we were cousins through marriage, but we're not blood related. But, and he just passed away. He was born in 1922. As I said, I was born in March of 1922. Dad was working in Klatskanai then, rafting cedar logs for telephone poles and then sending them down the river to be sold. While this work was going on, he rented a little house on a farm. It was meant for a farmhand, but the family didn't need a farmhand, so Dad and Mother rented it. I was just a baby at the time. Later, I remember going over to the big house to see their new baby girl. She eventually became my wife. Shirley was born in 1923, and she did not have any Swedish roots. When my Swedish relatives came from Sweden, they would stay with us to begin with. My uncle, Hjalmar Furberg, who became known here as Dale, came in 1926 and stayed for 2 or 3 years at that time. He was a young man and got a job up in Seattle painting houses with another fellow. He made a lot of money and went back to Sweden. Later he returned. We were living in Klatskanai at that time. He stayed for 2 or 3 years, if not longer, and went back to Sweden again. The next time he came to America, we were living in Skomakowa, up in the valley, and he stayed with us for a while. By this time, the Depression was going on, and I don't know how he was doing. I think he made 4 trips across the Atlantic. And that's very interesting, you know, that during the 1920s, it was actually cheaper to travel from Portland to Sweden than it was to live in a boarding room. So, you know, you can actually live kind of on the train and on the boat, and people went back and forth all the time. It's like flying today, it just took longer. But I didn't realize how much people traveled. So, but he did go back during the Depression, and this is the reason. Well, Uncle Hjalmar was there the last time, he got a letter from Aunt Dagny, and so that was my mother's sister. I remember it well. I was up in bed when he came. I was awakened when my mother came upstairs with a lamp and went to speak to Dale. She had had time to think about whatever it was he had told her when he arrived. And I remember her saying these words, "You must go home. You must go home now." She kept repeating it and telling him that there was no other way. What Aunt Dagny had told him in a letter was that she was pregnant, and Mother, being the senior woman in the Furberg family, told Uncle Dale that she would accept nothing but his return to Sweden. So he didn't stay here very long after that, but went back to Sweden, married Dagny, and moved in into an apartment in Skellefteå, which is up north. And I actually got to meet this uncle when I was a kid. And he'd had a stroke then, and he was kind of an invalid, but he did tell some stories from his time here. He worked in the woods a little bit, too. Then he had another uncle, also named Hjalmar, and that's kind of funny because Hjalmar isn't that common of a name. Uncle Hjalmar kept busy, the other Hjalmar, but during the Depression, things were tough. President Roosevelt and Congress had passed a repatriation law which said that the government would pay part or all of the expense to immigrants with families who would return to their country of origin. Uncle Hjalmar took this offer, and I don't think the journey cost him a penny other than what he had to pay for transportation to New York. The family left in 1933. He had been here for about 5 years. And so, you know, they talk about returning immigrants today too, and so it's not anything new really. And this was another, you know, confirms again the loss of the language. As I was growing up with my mother, she would never speak Swedish and wouldn't have anything to do with speaking it. If a Swedish word came up or a Swede came to visit and began to speak Swedish, she would tell them not to. She spoke immaculate English without a hint of a Swedish accent, and I don't think she ever opened a book on learning the language. She learned it all by reading magazines and such. And when her family came over from Sweden, she would never speak to them in Swedish. They knew a little bit of English, and that was enough. They could start, and she spoke English to them, and if they said anything to her in Swedish, she would straighten them out and tell them how it was said in English. and they had to learn. The fact that mother never wanted to speak Swedish was rooted in her belief that if you were going to be an American citizen, you need to learn the language. There was a newspaper called Svenska Posten printed in Seattle. It was in Swedish, and mother wouldn't read it if visitors brought it down for her, at least not in front of anybody. But I think that she secretly did read it because it would be around for a long time. Hjalmar Fjellström had a brogue he couldn't get away from, and when we were away from the house, he spoke Swedish to us. I also learned some Swedish from various fishermen and loggers, Johnny Swanson and some of the old bachelors living around Skomakowa. There was Hilding Berg, who spoke a lot of Swedish and told stories that really shouldn't be repeated. And he never told me what those stories were, but I suppose they were a little risque or something like that. You know, I could read, it's about quarter of, maybe one more snippet, and then I'll open it up for questions. Maybe I'll read this. Yeah, this is a pretty funny one. So this is a couple, they don't speak any English. They leave after World War II, and they go, you know, down by train and then into Denmark and over to England. On the ferry from Esbjerg in Denmark, there was a gentleman who said, "Whatever you do, watch out for the taxi drivers in England, because if they see that you don't know the language, they can really overcharge you." That was the main thing we thought about while standing at the train station with our suitcases and not knowing what to do. The man on the ferry had said that if we thought the driver looked suspicious, take out pen and paper and write down his number. While talking back and forth, Ellen did that because she thought that he really looked like one who could cheat you. Anyway, this lady from Finland wanted it understood that we should go with her to her hotel. She was booked into one hotel and we at another. She really wanted us to be with her, and it saved us a lot of dollars. Finally, we got to the hotel. Don't you think there was a man there who spoke Swedish? He was an American but had been in Sweden, and he helped us out. And oh, we were so lucky, I felt I was in heaven. The taxi driver was mad because he had spent a lot of time talking about our luggage and all that. He was going to charge us a pound, and I really didn't have that much money to throw away. So I ran out to the taxi to look at the meter while he was standing there. He hadn't changed it yet, and there was only 3 or 4 shillings on it. I told him, and he didn't charge more than that. We were really hungry when we arrived at the hotel, but I felt that what I needed was a soup, and in Swedish, that's a shot of liquor. We looked at the menu, not knowing what it said, but there was that one word, S-O-U-P, that seemed close enough. Ellen couldn't stop laughing when I was served a bowl of tomato soup. So you know, knowing the language is important in certain situations. So I think I'll start, you know, you can see, there it just goes on and on, full of wonderful little snippets of stories, you know. So some are sad, some are funny, others are kind of a little serious, you know, and open up a window to how life was. There's one here that I didn't read, but I like to read. And it's about this guy. He comes with his whole family. They work up at Bridal Veils, which was a logging place on the Columbia. It was a company town. Everything was owned by them. He worked 93 hours, and when they deducted rent and grocery bill, and you couldn't buy groceries anywhere except the company store, he had 25 cents to put in his pocket. 93 hours of work, 25 cents. You know, that was, you know, some of the realities of these Swedes that they came. They had a really, and then the father joined the union and got fired, of course. So then they had to live in a tent up by the highway all summer. So, you know, some of these Swedes had some really amazing lives, and it's very different from the kind of life that I have had as an immigrant, you know. We were taught Queen's English, but English nevertheless, from the age of 10. And I think most of us in my generation who came here, we were in our 20s, we thought we spoke pretty good English. We could understand most of what people said. There were many things I never could, you know, a body shop sounded kind of strange. You know, what is a body shop? What do they have there? You know? And then I came to California, and there was this X, I-N-G on the street, you know. It took me a long time, and I was like, X-ing? What's X-ing? You know, so there are all these things that you don't know. So it really takes a while to get into the language, but we had it a lot better than the people who came 100 years ago who didn't know a word, you know, who gets tomato soup when what they wanted was really something else. I think oral histories are really important because they reflect, they're a good antidote to sensationalism. They reflect true stories of ordinary people who have had very interesting lives that reveal, you know, many basic human experiences that are true, not just for Swedes, of course, but all people. It's, you know, it's the immigrant experience, starting a new life. There's a broad range of material in an oral history that not just reflects family and personal experience, but also is kind of a mirror for a larger context of historical forces at play, you know, like the loss of language, why people lose language, why people started remigrating during the Great Depression to Scandinavia, and so on and so forth, and what kind of work people did, and it sort of gives a glimpse of Swedish life that I think is alive because it is just ordinary people telling their life stories.